work, okay. I hope they're not feeding back. Every time I move, there's like a squeak. So please just, you know, dogs nearby are dying right now, I think. Anyway, so hi guys, my name is Angel. First off the bat, everyone wants to know if that's my real name. And yes, it is. I wouldn't have chosen it, it's stupid. My mother picked it. She's a middle child, I don't know her reasoning. But there is some, there's like a high-pitched buzz, hey? You guys can, that's bothering. Oh, look at you. No, I don't know if that's gonna work. Maybe, we'll just dance around, we'll move together. So my name, Angel, you can't really grow up with the name Angel in South Africa. No one takes you seriously, right? I have two mics, I feel like that's maybe what's going on. Well, I have to, apparently. That's what's going on, I believe you. Maybe if I move this further away. Guys, this is not working. Oh dear. Is there any way we can only use one feed? How's the sound coming on your side, sir? Sorry, guys.
One mic is for this.
Yeah.
The other is for the house.
Oh.
Yeah, and the reason that you're probably experiencing feedback is because there's speakers behind you.
So what can we do?
So the sound is coming from the speakers into your mic. We've got to make it softer.
Maybe if we could do that. Sorry, guys. Otherwise, it's going to drive us all slowly insane. But I'll just keep talking while we figure it out. So basically, the opening about my name, a little bit of context. Yes, growing up with the name Angel, no one takes you seriously. I didn't have a lot of career options growing up. You can't be a doctor or a lawyer or anything substantial, right? Like, imagine I even made it into med school, right? And then I'm working in the emergency ward of a hospital one night, and some kid comes in needing stitches. The nurse takes one look and that's like, ooh, let me just get Angel for you. A kid's gonna be like, no, mommy, you said it was a flesh wound. I'm not ready to meet grandpa and his new friends. And so that's out. And a lot of people ask me, Angel, are you a stripper? That's the common thing. Stand-up comedy, it works, and stripping. Those are my options. And no disparagement if you are a stripper. I respect those women. They figured out how to get paid for doing something we do every day for free, okay? Taking off your clothes. What? That's amazing. And if I was a stripper, let's be honest, we'd all be having more fun, I'd be making more money, and it'd be a win-win. So there's no disrespect to them, but obviously I didn't have the dance moves or the cleavage, so basically my family's very proud of me that I've made a career through stand-up. But my grandmother still gets suspicious when I say that I do orals on stage for a living. Okay? That word has changed since we were in primary school. The teacher used to walk into class, okay class, unprepared orals. Prepare ladies, always. Consent is important. But then we were like, yay, it's a free period. So many things have changed. But on we move. Anyway, so I'm here today to speak about equality, which is kind of ironic, a white South African speaking about equality. It would take a comedian to point out that irony, of course. Everyone else is like, don't bring it up. But no one's forgotten, guys. Oh gosh, that's not helping. Oh, there you go. We found a place. So yeah, because as white South Africans, we've got a history in South Africa that we wish didn't exist, and most people in our hearts are good people. And so when we get confronted with the past and the inequality of today, we immediately start to shut it down and say, well, no, we're all equal now, it's not, I'm colorblind, okay, colorblind, really. What happens when you meet a traffic light? Because it's just chaos. Like, colorblind is a very reductive term, and it's not necessarily something that's helpful. Because it takes away people's stories. And also, the only thing that really is colorblind is a dog. Most things are pretty racist, right? I never taught my dog to bark at black people, but it does. I don't know where it gets that from. So colorblind is not necessarily the terminology we want to go with. But the first step is like, I'm a white South African, and that's awkward. If we just own it, and then we can start to have the conversation. Because as soon as we shut down the conversation, we've ended it and we've become bad people, essentially, by trying to prove that we're good. So, I'm white South African, and that's awkward. At least I'm English, though. Ooh. Any Afrikaans, white South Africans in the house? No? There? There they are. Apartheid's their fault. And colonialism is ours. Exactly. We brought Cecil, you brought Pabut. We're all equal. It's exactly, and we do blame that on you behind your back all the time. Every English white South African has blamed apartheid on Afrikaans people whenever we get the chance. They're like, oh, human rights violation, but it wasn't us, it was the other one. But, so obviously I'm making Jeff because that's my career, and it's almost terrifying for me to drop it and to get more sincere. And most people, when they find out that I'm a comedian, they're always like, wow, you're so brave, that's terrifying, and that's always... And I understand why people project that fear into the realm of what I do. But Stephen King actually writes about the theory of horror, and that the monster behind a closed door is always more terrifying than when you open it, because our imaginations will make something far more terrifying. So whenever anyone imagines doing stand-up, we go into like French Renaissance with angry peasants trying to throw rotten tomatoes at us. That's like our worst fear. Like, what if they hate us? And fun fact, hello, welcome. Hi, guys. So fun fact though, like South African audiences are very polite. You guys are polite, you're all tolerating me. And in the comedy environment, it's much the same. No one's there hoping you fail. It's awkward if you fail. So it's not actually as terrifying as people think. And also, most people aren't walking around with rotten tomatoes on hand. No one's going to throw them. I say most because there's someone right now at Fruit and Veg City who's like unpacking old stock and is just putting some through some. Yeah. So, but in general, it's not actually a terrifying concept. And I would argue that comedy is literally the opposite of being vulnerable and terrified. It's stepping into your power and your truth. And I think everyone in here as a creative understands sort of standing by their ideals, and I would argue that everyone needs to embrace their comedian, because being a stand-up, I can say anything. Guys are just joking about apartheid, and I blamed it on Afrikaans people, but you guys are like, oh, she's fine, she's a comic. But we and it is amazing how the world opened up. I started stand-up about 6 years ago now, and the difference in how people, I can speak my mind all the time, and it's so empowering, because I'm a comic, leave me alone. Like, that's just what she does, oh, Angel. So, but I would argue, and especially women, now this is an interesting thing. Obviously, I was asked to speak on equality because I'm a woman in comedy. And this is a tired conversation for us. Everyone asks, what's it like being a woman in comedy? And as Philip pointed out, this is a majority female crowd. So you're all women in your fields, and you know, whatever pioneer you are, people say, what's it like being a woman in the boardroom? I don't know, I've never been a man. Like, it's a hard thing to answer, right? I don't know what it's like being a woman in comedy, it's just what I do. But it's actually interesting that when I started stand-up, my dating life literally crashed and burned. Yeah. It's so fascinating to the point that they've done studies that men make more jokes than women, and women tend to make no jokes when men are around, and actually statistically only joke when they're in all-female company. And they did a study in Harvard where they showed 300 students, this is back in 1998, 300 students photos of pretty girls and pretty guys, and the girls, and then underneath they had quotes. And the girls were 90% more likely to find a man attractive if the quote was funny or humorous, no matter if he wasn't textbook attractive just to look at. But interestingly, they showed men pretty girls, and the same prettiness on paper, the girls who had funny quotes were less attractive to them than the girls with bland or, which I can attest to, because, like, hello, gentlemen. And I've been looking into this since I started stand-up, because people are often surprised that this is an element. And what happens with comedy and why it's such a sense of power is that in the workplace, bosses that are rated as more popular are the ones who are funny. They've also proven that people who make more jokes with their colleagues climb the corporate ladder faster. So it's the new form of being an alpha. Correct. So when you're in a room, like right now, I'm your alpha, everybody, my little wolf pack. But you've all agreed to be quiet and to let me rule. And that is in stand-up, once you add all power. But in stand-up, so once I got off stage, men don't really know how to process a woman who has been an alpha. So it's a very emasculating thing. And it's no one's to blame. This is a societal, sexist, sort of ingrained thing, men and women. Women are more likely to say they want a man who makes them laugh. Men are more likely to say they want a woman who laughs at their jokes. So, until I meet a man funnier than me, it's just gonna keep going. But, just half kidding. So there is that very interesting dynamic. But when you look at the Amy Poehlers and Tina Fey's and, you know, Amy Schumer, Sarah Silverman, Eliza Schlesinger, Ali Wong, and in South African context, Tumi Morake, Celeste Ntuli, Mal Jones, the list is infinite. And yet men still say, why are women not funny? And after every second or third show, audience members come up to me and say, like, I usually don't find females funny, but you were funny. And every other girl comic will tell you exactly the same thing for some reason. And statistically, men try to make jokes more often. So they have hit and miss ratio probably higher than ours, but because they just keep trying to make jokes, we assume that they're funnier. And why do men make more jokes than women? Short answer, they're trying to get laid, guys. But that's, if you believe in like evolutionary psychology, it was the idea of attracting a mate, and humor is a sign of intellect, obviously, look at me. No, I'll stop. See, I can't be serious without throwing jokes in. But humor is statistically a sign of intellect, and when women were picking mates, like it's life or death if we get pregnant. So we don't want to, like back then, so we don't want to pick someone that's gonna give us, you know, a difficult child, so we would more likely go for an intelligent man, and so the funniest man would attract a woman. But we just, I don't know, had to have boobs and hips. There was no need for us to develop the personality to attract a man. So that's the psychology of why men are more funny than women. But really, if you look at the writers on any of the top comedy shows, the top-selling authors in the world, there is just a woman wave right now. So it's a good time to be alive. So that's the equality of being a woman in comedy. But the nice thing about the comedy community, and especially in Cape Town, but globally as well, is that it's not exclusive to me. It is a boys' club, obviously, but the rules in comedy in the group of comedians, if you're funny, you can hang. And it's so fascinating because the group of motley crew that it pulls together, I have friends that, like, you know, from Khayelitsha to Bishop's Court, from Jewish, Muslim, and everything in between, this group of comedians, and we're homies. And it's a beautiful thing, and that's the equality that I would prefer to focus on today. And the fact that there's the idea that when everyone laughs together, we get each other, and we start to create, and as comedians, we get to be accidental anthropologists, because it's a conversation, ultimately, comedy, with a group of people. So when I'm in a comedy club, and everyone's squished together, there's this ideology where people are trying so hard, you won't make a noise. There's this idea where everyone's sort of glancing at each other, can I laugh at this, is this okay? And the body language, everyone's reading each other. And I get to see couples that maybe arrive a little bit grumpy, leaving holding hands, and strangers leaving buying each other shots, and, you know, leaving together. And but it really does become a sense of that. And I'm honored to have been able to perform in places like, you know, Garankuwa in Pretoria, which is one of their biggest townships, as well as here in Buguletu at the beer halls. And the beautiful thing that I can tell you as a comedian, because we have our pulse on the South African nation, is that we are able to laugh at ourselves. And as messed up as our history is, that I spoke about at the beginning, I don't see it in other countries that they can talk about it as much as we do. And comedians are the modern-day philosophers, because we're the everyman. We're talking to people every night in clubs, in smoky rooms, talking about politics, and deciding if this is okay to laugh at, and a crowd will tell you very quickly what you can or can't joke about, and then we slowly start to see where the collective consciousness of South Africa actually is. And I can honestly tell you that I'm very optimistic about our country, because the difference between Garankuwa and Bishop's Court is minimal. People are all the same, and if only we could get those audience members and those audience members to watch together, then there'd be so much less of a divide in this country, because the equalizer of comedy and laughter is actually truly, truly beautiful, and I'm very optimistic about that. And there's an author whose name I'm going to have to look at. I've got it written down here. But he basically said his theory is that we evolved to laugh to avoid hitting each other with sticks. Okay. And there's a whole school of research that has proven that one of the ways the brain works with traumatic incidences is to break it down into laughter, and it's how we process it. And if you look at, you know, how many jokes came out about 9/11, and all the different improper things that we joke about, it's our way. And humor is completely subjective, I have to add. Like, it's like music in a way. There's a joke that goes, a communist joke isn't funny unless everybody gets it. But of course, not everyone always has to agree with a joke. And like I could say, Led Zeppelin versus Metallica. Which one's better? People are gonna get emotional. If I throw Justin Bieber into that mix, it's gonna become probably a ball. And no one's right or wrong in that debate. Music is music, it's got its audience. And the same goes for comedy. A really famous comedian is not necessarily a better craftsman with the jokes than an underground sort of unknown one, but each one finds its niche. So if I told you I saw someone falling down the stairs there and you're like, oh, that's terrible, you're a good person. But if you say, oh, did you get a video? You're my kind of person. But so it is, we find, and comedy, like what we laugh at does create groups. And this is where writing for a show like Czar News, which as Philip was saying, has been internationally recognized and that's amazing, and it's satire. And now satire's point is to comfort the afflicted and to attack the comfortable. And this is the problem. Sometimes comedy, people look at comedians when they've overcrossed the line and people go, oh, but comedy's mean, comedy hurts people. Yes, it can. But I would say comedy as a tool for social change is far more important. To start the debate around race as South Africans and to talk about things that we're not necessarily comfortable in a laughing context. So you can break taboos about sexism or racism or anything, homophobia. Comedians get to claim their truth and to talk about it. People sometimes say to me, yeah, wow, you're funny for a girl. One girl came to me and said, you're really funny, but you're also pretty. Why did you want to be a comedian? Oh, took a hit for feminism there. And then she goes, is that why you pull ugly faces while you talk? To distract people. Yes. You mean my face, okay. But it's so interesting that there's these prejudices, and I feel like I don't necessarily have to overly address being a woman or anything, just to be intelligent on stage and be funny, I'm doing my little bit for breaking the prejudice that women who look like her shouldn't be funny, right? And a little bit of backstory about me is that I only started stand-up when I was 28. I grew up, I knew I was funny, but so what, because I was a girl, right? We're socialized not to be funny. Girls are supposed to be polite and never bawdy, and when guys play sports, they mock each other. When we play sports, we're supposed to be supportive. So everything that you need to be a comedian is like beaten out of us as little girls, right? And so slowly but surely, it was like, I know I'm funny, but, and I enjoyed public speaking as a four-year-old. I used to tell the class stories. Everything in hindsight was adding up to doing stand-up. Which, by the way, opened all the doors to radio presenting and TV writing and everything. I'd been banging on that door until I found stand-up, and the kitchen door opened, and I was like, oh, other entrance. But I had, and I knew that I liked performing, so I thought, no, well, then let me be an actress. So all through high school, I was going to be an actress. And then I started trying with that, and then I was like, no, but I also want to control what I say. And I also wanted, so I'm going to write, direct, and star. Oh, the dream. Hey? And in South Africa, that's such a dream. Unless you're doing student films, that's never going to happen. So I studied film and media at UCT, and then I was directing, and then I wanted to be in front of the camera. So I was constantly juggling it. But stand-up comedy literally is writing, directing, and starring. So I was like, I found it. This is it. And people will always tell you that a comedian is a broken bird, a bird with a broken wing, and we all have this deep angst. And like, sure, yeah, my dad had bipolar, and my mom was the second of five wives, and like, there's all sorts of chaos. And arguably, yes, I developed a sense of humor to survive moving school a million times. But also, I would argue that everybody has something inside them. Everybody's a little bit of a bird with a broken wing. We've all got stories. Comedians, on the other hand, get to speak them out and tell people. One of my biggest jokes at the moment is about my dad's funeral, okay? And it's a true story. So now I've taken a story that was potentially sad, well, potentially was sad, and I make a group of strangers laugh about it every night. Do you know the power of stepping into your sadness and taking away the taboo? Every comedian will tell you that comedy is our therapy, and the best part is you pay us, so. Like, amazing. So that's what I want to leave you guys with, that comedy, when aimed at the right people, the people above us, the government or people in power, white men, sorry, and that kind of thing, it can do social change and it can punch the correct way. You can make your point, but you don't punch down because then you're just a bully, right? So you do have to find that and pagans will sometimes cross the line, but so what I want to leave you with is, it is your sense of power. Women, make more jokes in the workplace, okay? Because it's inappropriate, sure, but you'll also align people. People will either hate you or love you for what you stand for. And we can't just sit on the fence anymore. We've just got to stand in our truth. And the more edgy my comedy's been getting over the years, the more I've realized I have to just stand for what I'm saying, because I do get people who disagree with me, and that's fine. My most recent hour special is called Devil's Advocate, because especially in South Africa, because of our past, we're so subdivided into little pockets, and we don't interact with each other enough. I'm lucky in my career, I do get to cross all the boundaries, but the average South African, our Facebook communities, are people we've always known from our and the news stories we click on are headlines that we already want to agree with. We don't go out of our comfort zone. But I would argue that you guys lean in, woman, and grab your power, although you're sitting in here late, so, but it is proven to make us stronger, make us stand for what we believe, and also the arguments, the debates are not necessarily negative, you know, we don't have to shy away from a debate, we stand for, strengthen our beliefs, and yeah, so from a comedian's perspective, South Africa is going to be just okay, and hopefully soon, great. And equality is attainable. Yeah. I think that's my closing. Yeah. Check my notes. Okay, thank you guys.